的差，大地森林
expressing our love to our maker. So I just want everybody in church to just say, Jesus, I love you. So wait, I want you guys to picture Jesus like a babe now, especially for the dude. And for the ladies, picture Jesus like one fine dude that you actually have crush on. And imagine him in your front right now and be like, Jesus, I love you. See these people, say, Jesus, I love you. Come on.
Jesus, I love you.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jesus, the Son of God, I believe in you. I believe in you. Jesus, the Son of God, I believe in you. I believe in you. Jesus, the Son. Do you believe in that man that you claim you love? I want the church to sing with me. Jesus, the Son of God.
Jesus, the Son of God.
I believe in you, Jesus. We believe in you. One more time, just the church alone. Jesus, the Son of God, we worship you. Alright, I want everybody to join me. Jesus, Jesus, the Son of God. Come on.
Jesus, the Son of God. I love you forever. I love you forever. I love you forever. Lord.
Quiet, join me, sing.
I love you, Jesus. Forever, Jesus. Forever, I
expressing that love you claim to have for Jesus with the words of your lips. Just start calling Jesus' beautiful name. All of those names that you know that you will appreciate. Just begin to worship Jesus.
Your love is kind. Your love is patient. You fill my heart with so much peace and joy. And you're amazing, Jesus.
Somebody sing, you're amazing. One more time, come on, sing.
And you're amazing. You make my life feel brand new.
Listen.
Hey, Jesus, your love is too much. Thank you, believe in me.
I just want you to raise those hands to the heaven. I just say, Jesus, thank you for loving me. Thank you for giving your life for me. Thank you for giving me salvation. Because sometimes I just wonder if we are actually in the days of the road, whereby we sacrifice for mercy and we sacrifice oxen and mother sheep for our sins. But we don't keep plenty sheep. I would have killed so many sheep. So just say, Jesus, thank you for loving me. Thank you for your salvation, Jesus. Thank you for your salvation, Jesus. Just begin to just thank Jesus, just thank Jesus. So much love. Thank you for loving me so much. Listen, says, just pray your name upon me. Just pray your name upon me, pray. Yet here I hear is your name, pray Lord. Just pray your name upon me. It's all about Jesus this morning. Just pray your name, come on. When you breathe his name upon you, breathe his love upon you. So just breathe your name, Jesus.
Just breathe your name upon me. Breathe.
Breathe,
Lord.
Just breathe your name.
Just breathe your name upon me.
Somebody say, just breathe.
Just break your name upon me. Just break your name upon me.
Hallelujah. Please be seated and praise the Lord. Apparently, our guest minister has a little hitch. He's on his way. He'll be here soon. But in the interim, we'll watch a video that also aligns with the theme for the month. And as soon as he comes up, we'll continue with the service. So please, let's media the video. Please, thank you, choir.
I want to quickly do a quick disclaimer. Because I know that House on the Rock is full of very tush people, people that are very eloquent and all that, I'm going to try my best. But I can guarantee you that at some point, the Niger Delta in me will rise. So if at any point I switch out of the English that my father paid for when he sent me to Corona, I will try to retrace my steps. I want to quickly do a quick disclaimer. Because I know that House on the Rock is full of very tush people.
Adebelu is a child of God, a public health advocate, a role model, and mentor to many. A firm but friendly teacher of God's word, Ayo is passionate about young people entering into the fullness of all God has destined them to be. Ayo is an alumnus of the School of Disciples, Redeemed College of Missions, Redeemed Christian Bible College, and Obafemi Awolowo University, Ile-Ife. A relentless worshipper, Ayo is also the National Director of Music, Arts, Presentations and Production in the National Youth and Young Adult Affairs of the Redeemed Christian Church of God. He also serves as the Assistant Coordinator of the Pastor Seed Family Worldwide. Powerhouse, with Jesus' joy in our hearts, let us welcome Pastor Ayoride Adebelu.
Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Powerhouse, praise the name of the Lord. Can we celebrate God in this house this morning? He's worthy of all glory, all honor, all praise, all adoration. Come on, give him your best. Give him your best. Don't clap as a form of tradition. Clap because you genuinely, intentionally want to give God the best of your praise. Hallelujah. Amen. Father, we thank you this morning. We bless your name because only you deserve it. Be thou exalted in Jesus' name. Lord, your word is coming forth now. And we are talking about a very interesting yet sensitive topic this morning. We're asking, oh God, that you would give our hearts the grace to receive the truth. In the name of Jesus. Whatever needs to be broken in our emotions, in our character, in our perceptions, break them down.
Whatever walls need to come down, tear them down. Today we ask that as your word finds entrance into our hearts and our spirits, that it will transform us. It will change us for the better. Thank you, Lord Almighty. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Praise the name of the Lord. Powerhouse, praise the name of the Lord. Let's be seated in God's presence. I want to apologize. I came a bit late. Lagos and this first Cassidy is causing unnecessary gridlocks on the road. But I'm glad I'm here, and I'm glad that you are here. And when I got the invitation to speak on this topic today, I smiled and I then laughed. I smiled and I then laughed because from a very long time ago, right from my campus fellowship days, whenever we wanted to talk about relationship and all, I wasn't the pastor of the fellowship. I was just a worker in the fellowship, but I was in counseling department. That's where I served in RCFOU. And so follow-up and counseling. So whenever I came to relationships, everybody would say, go and look for Ayo. Ayo knows what to say, and he knows how to say it. And I wondered why, and I guess it was because maybe I saw my own home as an example. And like I said today, I'm going to be asking some very personal questions. But before I go on, I want to thank the pastor and the ministers of Powerhouse for bringing me back again. The Lord honor you in Jesus' name. And I also want to celebrate my friend, my boss, one of the ministers in my church, Pastor Tobi Ololade. Pastor Tobi, thank you for joining me here. So I'll start practically. Then we go into the scriptures, which is even the most practical. If you are here, and please take no offense, we're just doing a simple poll. It's a simple poll. If you are here and while you were growing up, you had your two parents with you, training you, grooming you, raise up your hand. Daddy and mommy were there. Raise it up. My hands are up. My hands are up. Because some people are now becoming shy. Don't be shy of your past. It made you who you are. It's part of your process, your growth process. Okay, put your hands down. Now, those of you who raised your hands, if you lived in a house where dad and mom were there, but they slept in separate rooms, raise up your hand. Okay? Okay? Okay. Those who are raising their hands, if the separate rooms was because if they were monogamous and they were staying in separate rooms, raise up your hand. Okay, put your hands down. Now, if you're like me, that dad was never there. Not that he died. Not that he had an accident, but he was never there. He was there like he was not. Raise up your hand. Okay, good. Now, if you are here and you ever felt that your mates were better than you, or there was a time in your life you felt a little bit inferior because your friends or your schoolmates or your classmates had both parents in their lives, visibly, actively in their lives, and you just had one parent, not because that parent died, and I say this again, not because the parent died, but because the parent was just absent in your life, can you just raise up your hand? Thank you for being honest. Thank you for being honest. Now, the reason why I have said this today is because a lot of people, when you talk about relationships, marriage, and all, there is a tendency that people always think about love. Yes, there's a tendency that people always think about love. But I'm not going to start from there this morning, because over my years of experience, I do, before and after, that's the topic. I do before and after. I have realized over a period of time that no matter the relationship you get into, there is one part that needs to be sorted. If that part is not sorted, nothing will ever be sorted. And that part is I. Do is a function of I. How do comes out is a function of I. In Exodus chapter 3, and that's where we're starting from, Exodus chapter 3, if you read from verse 1, Moses was asking the Lord, and he said, if I ask people who sent me, where am I coming from? Can I have it on the screen, please? Exodus chapter 3 from verse 1. Exodus 3:1.
Exodus 3:1. I like it on the screen so everybody gets to read it at the same time. Media team, kindly help me. Thank you. Exodus chapter 3, verse 1. Thank you very much. Okay. And Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. Let's stop there. So Moses was doing something productive in his life. He was doing something profitable. He was busy. He wasn't jobless. So not like as if he was idle or he lacked what he wanted to do. That was not the case here. Moses was, he lived a productive life. And there are many people today, this morning, in this church, who have very good jobs, who have very good careers, who look like as if they are succeeding. They are financially, they are in their career. But you see, your financial success and your career success will never contribute to your relationship success. Will never, if the part of I is not sorted out. Now, when you get home, read the entire chapter. So God tells Moses, you are going to deliver my people from the hands of Pharaoh. So Moses asks, who will I say is sending me? And God looks at Moses and says, tell them I am that I am. You see, the entity of God, what gives God his personality, what gives God his authority is that he knows who he is. He's complete in himself. He doesn't need you to feel good. He doesn't need you to feel happy. He doesn't need you to feel successful. He's happy all by himself. He's not dependent on anyone for emotional stability. That's what makes God God. And if you are going to succeed at anything, you must be comfortable in your own skin. You must be. Now, the reason why I asked the first question was because when I was young, I grew up under a single parent, in a single parent home. But you see, my mom was worth 10 men. My mom was worth 10 men. People will come with their husbands, and I will wonder where this man was, why he would not show up. But the truth is, it took me a while before I could correct that perception about myself that I was not less because I was raised by half. And many people today come to church, look good, but you see, in the choice moment, one word from them to them can destroy every form of confidence. I'm going to dig deep a bit. Because there are people who are married. Okay, let me talk to the ones who are not yet married. It's what I was talking about before. The fact that you're not yet in a relationship, the fact that no guy has spoken to you does not make you less than one who is in a relationship. The fact that you have been served breakfast, lunch, and supper. Okay. If you know... Let me still be a good boy. Please don't let me. Don't let me, sir. But the fact that you've been served breakfast, lunch, breakfast is still fine, though. Breakfast is fine. Why breakfast is fine is that if you are served breakfast, you can still recover and eat lunch. Am I making sense? If you are served lunch, you can still recover and have dinner. But if you are served dinner, if you don't get it, so that's that is what you must understand, that these things happen. And when people come and when people go, daddy died when you were young, mommy left daddy and left you to this, the first guy broke your heart, the girl took, at the end of the day, it still remains I. And if there's a dysfunction in I, there can be no function in I's relationship. So if you are not confident, if you are not comfortable, if you are not confident and comfortable in who you are, not about what you have, because there are two different things. If what you have is what gives you confidence, then you have a weak point. It means I know what to do to get you.
If you put your confidence and your sense of self-esteem in the material things that you have or in the words of affirmation that you get. Now, listen to me very carefully. I am not saying that you should ignore or not appreciate words of appreciation. Of course, we have the love languages, gifts, presents, touch, words of affirmation, and all that. We have all these things. But I tell you, if you don't bring any my way, I am happy all by myself. That's the truth. And so you must understand, young man, trying to make a living, it's good. Trying to make some money, it's good. But if all you can think about is what you can use to pump up, pump is P-U-M-P, pump up your self-esteem in front of people, believe you me, you have all men most miserable. When the devil came to tempt Jesus after 40 days of fasting, he came to test his personality and perception about himself. He said, if you know that you are the Son of God, and that is the mistake many of us made in secondary school, I double dare you. And so you were double dare to touch breast, you were double dare to write love letters, you were double dare to be foolish. Because the moment you think you have a need to make a point to someone about something, you've given the person the upper hand. And that's why Jesus said, I don't owe you any explanation. I know who I am. I don't need to turn stones to bread to let you know who I am. I know who I am. So if your sense of identity is not complete, you're a confused human being. And there's nothing danger than a confused human being entering into a relationship. Do you know why? He will always be suspicious. She will always be suspicious. She sees you. You just said hi to the girl. That's all you said. Hi. Why are you smiling at her like that? Because it brings insecurity. I am focusing on this because this is the foundation. And if the foundation be destroyed, there's hardly anything the righteous can do. So ask yourselves, right? Number one, am I confident and comfortable in myself? These are the questions you need to ask. Some men like chasing fine girls because they think they are ugly, so the fine girl will balance the equation. That's the truth. A girl thinks that because she's short, she can't marry a short guy. She wants a tall guy, so she gets a tall antichrist. Of course, I want him to be 6 feet tall, and six-figure salary, have six packs, 666, the mark of the beast. What do you think? It's just a joke. I'm not saying if you get one, that's not it. But be careful of what you ask for. So I is the foundation, because even God himself, I is his foundation. The day there is a fracture in your eye, whatever you do is flawed. That's the truth. So before you say I do, I want to help you understand who your eye is. Are you still feeling, swimming in the hurt of something that happened to you in your past? Then that means your eye is fractured. Your hands have not let go of the past. How can there be space for the present? Someone broke your heart last year. Now somebody wants to mend it. But guess what? You have used the sins of the past to judge the future. So somebody was like, men are, what are they calling? Eh? You know, it's amazing. I laugh a lot because it's true. They've said it before, but it's true. After all these people shout, men has come. The next thing we hear is, she got married. She was engaged. I'm like, you want not? You? If your self-esteem is judged by what you see on social media, how many likes and followers you have, I pity you. You know, Jesus fed 5,000. With five loaves of bread and two fishes. And after he fed 5,000, they came the next day. And when they came and they sat down, Jesus looked at them and realized that these ones did not come for the word. They came for bread. And he told them, I said, I know it's because of the miracle that I performed yesterday. That's why you are here today. In fact, I have nothing left to say to you. Get out of here. and Jesus Christ chased away a 5,000 congregation. I asked myself, he was a parish pastor in the Redeemed Christian Church of God. Sir, his sack letter will be waiting for him before he resumes. If you were a parish pastor, I dare say, in the Redeemed Christian, in any church, and you said a word and 5,000 people left the church, you are gone. But Jesus did not care. Send 5,000 people away. And this is what got to me. He looked at his disciples and said, would you also go? If you want to go, you can go. I know who I am. I know what I can give. I know what I can deliver. I will not reduce who I am to make you feel good about who you are. And there are too many people who have refused to shine their shine because they are afraid that if they shine too much, somebody will come and bring them down. So you have defrauded God of everything he deposited inside of you. You don't get what I'm saying. Let me help you. There are some ladies who never know their guy. Don't let your guy know how smart you are. If he knows how smart you are, he'll be threatened by you and he'll just ditch you. Then that was not the guy for you. A lioness does not follow a goat. She follows a lion. So if the guy is going to feel inferior or feel intimidated by your intelligence, babe, move up, move up. That's not your standard. Move up. But if you have to reduce who you are, he says that, you know, I'm not tall. Whenever you wear heels beside me, I feel somehow reduce your, hey, hey, babe, 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 babe. It means he not only has a problem or a challenge with his stature, he also has a problem and a challenge with his status. Because at every point in time, I look at you, I am more interested in the status than the stature. Why? David didn't have the stature, but he brought Goliath down. And by the time he brought Goliath down, they said Saul had killed thousands and David had killed 10,000. So the guy beside you, what? Before you say, I do, your eye. Why are you going to the gym? Is it for health? Or so that you can unbutton two shirts and take pictures and then look like the nose of a pig? If you're a teenager, it's still understandable. But as you grow into manhood, as you grow into womanhood, I want to encourage you. You need to work on your eye. Every hurt of your past, it might be difficult to let go. If you need to find help, find it. If you need to speak to your pastor, if you need to go and meet the person who hurt you, have an open heart conversation with the person and say, guy, this is what you did. I don't care if you accept it or not, but I've just told you and I've moved on. But the moment you hear that person's name and something like, why is this succeeding? After all he did to me, you have not gone. You've not let go. I keep saying it everywhere. If the reason why your prayer is so that you can be rich is that one day you can buy a Jeep and when it's raining, you can drive and splash water on that person, then you are the person that Paul is talking about when he said you pray and receive not because you pray amiss. I'm telling you what I'm going through. Because when I found it difficult to let go, Jesus Christ said, what was my last words before I said, Father, I give up the ghost? He said, Father, forgive them. For they know not. If Jesus was a Nigerian on that cross, he'll be like Samson. Ajomakukuini. I will die for you, but you will also die. Do you get my point? Now, no, you also need to understand, I don't use spirituality to cover this thing. I don't believe in love. I'm a man of war. I'm in the bush. There are many brothers who have used tongues to cover hurt. If you don't heal it, the danger of that is that it is at the height of your glory. It will now appear and bring you down. Moses did not work on his eye. He had anger issues. I remember the story when God told him, this is the same Moses, though he was a good man. God said, I'm going to kill all the children of Israel. And Moses said, Father, if you will kill them, blot my name out. So he was a good man. The Bible called him the meekest man on the surface of the earth. God told Miriam and Aaron, I speak to you in dreams and visions, but I speak to Moses mouth to mouth. We don't use face masks. We talk really. And this is the same Moses. When God said, speak to the rock, in a fit of anger, in a fit of anger, Moses insulted the children of Israel and then hit the rock. Now, this is where you must understand. Water still came out. Because one would have thought that because he disobeyed the instruction of God, he would have been disgraced and water would not come out. Water still came out. But where it ended him up, his eyes saw the glory. The people he labored for got into the glory. But he himself never got in. Every flaw in your eye, every hurt in your eye, every wound in your eye that will deliver evil, sadness, disappointment to you, whether now or in future, in this service, the Lord heals it in Jesus' name. So when we talk about these issues, as much as you can be a fire breather, in fact, let me help you here. Some of you, the reason why God has not given you the anointing you're asking for is because there's something wrong with your eye. Telling you. You don't understand? So, when they came to get Jesus, Peter said, Lord, what are we waiting for? Let's call down fire the way Elijah called down fire. Jesus said, shut up. Elijah did not have the heart of the, because I am sure as Elijah was killing 101 people, God was like, Elijah, some of you are here. If you become powerful, Shango will be your new name. And God is unwilling to get you promoted at work. God is unwilling to hand over that anointing to you. God is unwilling to put that greatness in your hands because you've not healed your eye. What you must understand is that the higher you go, the more patient you have to become. That's the truth. Have you seen when in the Nigerian political system, when we had one pressure group president, then I won't mention names, but whenever he leads a strike in this nation, Nigeria is paralyzed. And he'll be, I'm fighting for the people. And then all of a sudden he cross-carpeted. If you mention name, please show the person that mentioned it to. And then he became a governor. And then all of a sudden his song changed. You know, we have to be patient with the government. The first I said, Jesus. But the truth is, when you are not the one at the lead, you can say whatever you like. But the moment you have authority in your hands, then to be able to bear the burden of leadership, your eye must be patient enough to be the dustbin of everybody. Because people will say whatever they like about you. Some will be true. Some may not be true, but yet you will have to accommodate everybody. I do before. Work on your eye. Now, can you help yourself this morning? I'll give you 3 minutes. This is personal to you. I don't know if you need a journal for this or you need to write out in that jotter, but it's a practical class. Can you write down what you have not let go of? Can you just be truthful with yourself? Nobody needs to see what you are writing. You don't need to say, I know it's in my mind. No, write it out. Write it out. No, seriously, write it out. You may be able to prove to me with bold face that you have let go, but you know that within you, there's still something. There's still something. You just wish that you could just die and disappear. Then you know that he's no longer on this earth. Is there something? Write it down. Maybe there's something a teacher said to you, a lecturer said to you. Or there's something somebody said. Maybe somebody body shamed you. Somebody said something or cracked a joke about you on social media. Whatever it is, write it down. Just write it down. Write it down. Write it down. Help yourself. Before I close, I'm going to... Well, going to have some activities about that. Write it down. So before you see I do, work on your eye. Now, the reason why I can't be specific with your eye is because we're all different from each other. So what you need to work on in your eye is different from what I need to work on in my eye. But as long as your eye is sound, as long as your eye is confident, as long as your eye is comfortable in your skin, then whatever the eye does becomes fruitful. So if you are here and you're not yet in a relationship, raise up your hand. You're not yet, you've never been in, raise up your hand. That, can I help myself? Can I help you? Okay, stand up. Never been in a relationship, never. You may have had crushes, but you've never been. Thank you, sir. Come out. It's a class. I didn't come out. Since I begin to happen here. Never been. It's only this brother in this church. Brothers, why are we lying? Never been, no. Only one brother and one sister. But I don't... Brother, can you remove the face mask? Okay, thank you. Sister, can you remove the face mask? You can stand apart, don't worry. Just stand up. Ah, I like that smile. Brother, where's your own rose? They didn't give you rose. Bring it. Go and bring the rose, don't worry. Brother, you see, let me explain something to you now. Think about your eye. Like I see you're a strong man. Sometimes when we men have had a hard life, everything about us is hard. But I love you. See the way you're holding the rose. I'm afraid the rose will break. Brother, hold that rose gently. Brother, don't. What's your name, sir? Eh? Wale. That's my namesake. I'm Ola Wale. All right. No. The way you're holding the rose, like as if it's king. There's a way you hold a rose. There's a way, you know, it's about your personality. Some people hold those like this. There's a way you hold a rose that it's just a simple hold, but it's so gentle. It gives a reflection of your eye. So let us have a reflection of your eye now. Praise the Lord. Now, we're going to part two of this. And then I close. I want to use both of them as an example. He has never been in a relationship. She has never been in a relationship. Two things can happen. One, whatever perception each one of them has about a relationship can either be influenced by somebody else who has been in a relationship. Now, if the person has been in a relationship and that person's eye was flawed and that person did not have an easy relationship, if that is all the story they hear about the guy, that girl, no guest sense, women, see the way she did this, he himself, without having entered a relationship before, his perception is already being formed. If her friends are people who had flaws in their eyes, and maybe they went into relationships that didn't work, and all she has ever had as she has been growing up is that you see, men, I'm just telling you from experience. So at the end of the day, whichever guy that will be quote and unquote, whichever guy that will have the task of winning her heart will have a hard time. Because without ever having been in a relationship, get my point, there's already a wall. A wall based by the perception of others. So people have transferred perception onto them. I call it casting. They've casted their perception on them. Just like in school, you are in part two. You have not gotten to part three. But people who are in part three are telling you that, man, worry, MTH 301 is waiting for you. Ah, tsunami. People fail that course like anything. You have not gotten to 300 level. The course is already making you afraid. Are you getting my point? Both of you can. Wait, what's your name? Grace. Great. Wow. You're the first sister I'm hearing bearing great. The brothers usually bear great and sisters bear grace. But you are great. You are special. You can go to your seat. Wale, you will be great. You can go to your seat. Hallelujah. You must not allow anyone cast their own perception of their own experience onto you. Are you getting my point? Because these are the things that can affect your eye. Sometimes your eye is good. There's nothing wrong with your eye. You are okay. But all you have ever heard, all you've ever seen is negative, negative, negative. A time comes when those perceptions begin to permeate into your mentality. So don't let someone's experience be your own exposure. It's good to learn from people's experience, but it does not necessarily mean that that person's experience will be yours. I hope you are getting me. All right, so we move. After, there is a mistake of thinking that the girl is a prize and that once she's won, you can now do as you like. That's a big mistake. That is a big mistake. Because you see, when you were in courtship, you made her a promise. But now that you are married, you made her a covenant. You can break a promise and go scot-free. But if you break a covenant, it will take exceptional mercy and grace for redemption to happen for you. And that is why before you carry a woman before God and before man and make a covenant that in everything you do, in sickness and in health, in riches and in poverty, in everything, she'll be your one and she'll be your all after Christ. It's a dangerous thing for you to think, now you are in my house. You can't be doing shakara for me again. Brother, let me tell you something. If you marry wrongly, a wife can frustrate your destiny. That's it. You must understand these things. And my dear sisters, it is in marriage now we'll now begin to see the real you. We know that we don't know all of you. All of you want that happen. That doesn't happen before marriage. It's in marriage you get all of him and all of her. That's when you get the snorings. That's when you get the guy who throws his boxers here, his singlets there, his one leg of socks there, one leg of socks there, and then when it's time to wash, it becomes ultimate search. And you're like, my God, why are you so disorganized? See me, you're saying I'm disorganized? Are you getting my point? So once you have said I do, the first thing you must understand is this. You must honor each other. Because your wife has taken the position of number one before your parents. Your husband has taken the position of number one before your parents. And I want to show my guys something here. Girls, don't take advantage of this, I beg you. Please, I beg you, don't take advantage of this. But I just wanted to point this out. It's still something I'm looking at. It's still something I'm considering. And I want to see whether, Genesis chapter 2, verse 24. Genesis 2:24. Media team, please. Genesis 2:24. All right. Are we there? Are we going to read together? One, two, go. Men, listen to me. Read it again. Only the brothers. One, two, go. But by our culture and our tradition here, who leaves the parents and goes to join the other one? Eh? It's the one that leaves, Abby. That leaves her family. and goes to cleave to her husband. But what did the Bible say? I know you're getting confused now. Because all your life, you've always been told it's the woman that leaves her family. You go to her house and then she'll be crying as she's leaving. She's crying and they're waving and she's following you home. But the Bible says it is you, man. The brothers are all of a sudden so quiet. That's why I prayed for grace to receive the truth. It is the man that actually does the living, leaves family, leaves everybody, and then comes and cleaves to his wife. Brothers, if you are not ready to leave, you cannot cleave. I know it's the sisters that are clapping. The brothers' hands are folded. I understand. Like I told them, I said, there will be some hard truths that people will hear. Oh. Brother, smile at me. Now, that is it. That's what the Bible says. But the Bible compensates for it by now making you the head of the home. But in reality, it is you that leaves your comfort zone. It's you that leaves the people you know. It's you that leaves everything and says, I am leaving all this. Why? Because Christ himself left the glory of heaven. That's why I said, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. So Christ left his throne. Christ has shown us the perfect example. He left heaven and came down to where man was to die for man. So once you are married, you know now that it's not your wife. Because when I hear and when I do marriage counseling for couples, say that is why you don't have the authority to say, I will send you back to your father's house. You don't have the authority. You will leave my house and go back to your father's house. It was you that left your own father's house and came to meet her. Church is so quiet. I don't see anybody shouting glory now. Now, some brothers, don't start thinking twice about marriage. You will still get married. But it's a life of sacrifice. Jesus forgot who he was. Forgot he was the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He left his glory. So it was like coming to America. And came down and walked amongst men and decided to cleave to man. Do you know why you need to understand this, my brothers? Because that is when you realize that if this woman goes, you have everything to lose. And so when you are married, I didn't say your girlfriend. Please take note. I didn't say your girlfriend. I didn't even say your fiancé. I said your wife. That is why the moment you marry her, her position changes. She stands directly beside you, not behind. Beside. Let everything go. This one, you protect with everything you have. And so when you stand there and you lift up the veil of our eyes, I'm like, glow! I hope you understand. I hope you understand that when she touches your shoulder with suit on that day and you look back and you see her, I hope you understand. Don't be carried away by the makeup and the beauty. Prepare yourself for the sacrifice ahead. In the book of Proverbs, the Bible says, he that finds a wife finds a good thing. He that finds a wife. He that finds a wife. There are too many sisters here who have not modeled themselves into becoming a wife. They are still doing girlfriend. Each one of you here must develop yourself into a wife material. He that finds a wife, a wife, a wife. A means it can be anybody. It is only when you find your wife and be joined to his, it is only when you find your wife that you are now allowed to cleave together. Because there are many brothers now, what they do is that they are looking for wife materials all about, but they are not ready to commit to marriage. And so, they have emotional sex with these ladies. They have physical sex with these ladies because I love her. She can cook. She has a degree. She's exposed. She's educated. They begin to enjoy the apple, but they don't want to tend the garden. So you must understand this morning that after you see I do, it is a lifetime of responsibility. You must honor one another. Number two, you must be gentle with your words. You must be gentle with your words. If you are hot-tempered, then you must be. If you cannot change, then you can't go into marriage. Because after you become one, you automatically become the Lamb of God. You can shout at your children if you wish, but you dare not shout at your spouse. You can't shout at your wife. You can't shout at your husband, whether in public or in private. I have seen some men insult their wives. I know those insults that are not insults, that you have to be intelligent to understand it was an insult in the first place. You do not insult each other, and you do not stand for anybody insulting anybody. One, I love that the Geo, he says it anywhere he goes. Says you can insult me, you can abuse me, you can do whatever you like to me, and I won't raise a finger. But if you touch my wife, I will kill you. Said, I don't need to use a gun or a cutlass to kill you. I will only speak to my father. That is how valuable your spouse should be to you. You hear women say, it's old school for women to be kneeling down for men. No. But when he was kneeling down to propose, you loved it. You know, it's amazing our sisters this day. You have already known the engagement date. You have known the wedding date. You have printed IV card. They now just propose out. And now suddenly, proposal ago melo at what time? But guess what? He knows that you are going to get married. But because of how much he values you, he knows you love the pomp, the pageantry, the organizing, the everything, the surprise of being surprised. He knows. And guess what? He goes through all the lengths just to get that done for you. And then before the whole world, you are waiting for his knees to touch the ground. Like, oh yeah. And then some are very terrible. You know, will you marry me? Like, the boys have to beat him big. Hey. And then when he now comes into marriage, he now say, I don't kneel down for any man. The Bible says Sarah was not afraid to call Abraham my Lord. It is not a sign of demotion. It's a sign of submission. Submission is not that you bow down yourself. I keep telling people, submission is proving when you have means. Let me give you an example. So you're a wife. You want to travel to Dubai for shopping. And you go tell your husband, honey, I need to go to Dubai for shopping. And honey says, babe, I don't have money for Dubai for shopping. And then you say, okay, and you sit down. And then you say, oh, my husband said he doesn't have, I didn't give him headache, I'm a submissive wife. That's not submission. Submission is when you go to your husband and say, honey, I want to go to Dubai for shopping. Oh, I don't have money. Don't worry, I don't need your money. I have my money. I don't want you to go to Dubai for shopping. And you choose not to go, not because you didn't have the money to take yourself there, but because your husband said, that is submission. Jesus Christ had the power to give his life and what? And take it back. He had the power. But the Bible says in Philippians chapter 2 that he humbled himself unto death, even the death on the cross. Submit yourselves to one another. In your words. Proverbs chapter 15 verse 1. Proverbs chapter 15 verse 1. It says a soft answer, it turns away wrath. How do you speak? You speak more politely to your pastors. And then when you get home. Now, please, I learned something early in life. That because she calls you daddy, mommy, that does not mean she respects you. Because I've had things like daddy showing English. Meaning daddy, is your head correct? Mommy showed you your fault. Mommy, say your eyes are not blind. You know, it's a method they will use. Nyi. Nyi is a respectful noun. And they'll say, mommy showed you nyi. So you now wonder. You honor yourselves. Honor. You make sure that you give each person that pride. And it's not just about the outside. Honor means I want to make a decision. What do you think? Your opinion counts in the decision that I want to make. You must be open to questioning. Why are we doing this? For what reason? Can you give me an explanation? No, I am the head of this home. And if I give instructions, you follow. She's not your house girl. Then moving on. I think I'm giving the fourth point now. If you know you want your after I do, your marriage to work, you need to pray for wisdom. 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 I tell people, love does not sustain a marriage. Listen to me. Let me say it again. Love does not what? Many of us grew in homes where our mother said, it's because of my children I stayed in the marriage. How many of you have heard that statement before? That mothers will say, I would have left him long ago, but it's because of my children. So love for each other does not necessarily hold a marriage together. That's the truth. I have seen marriages where they divorced. And you see the husband. And you say, do you still love your wife? Oh, I love her. I still love her. But why are you divorced? I can't live with her. She's mad. But you love her. Yes. But I can't live with her. She's just nuts. She's crazy. Wisdom. Proverbs chapter 24. We'll read that together. Proverbs chapter 24. Proverbs chapter 24. Verse 3. And I want to read it both in King James and in the Message version if we have it. But give me King James first. Yes. Said, through wisdom, are we following? A house is built, and by understanding, it is established. Do we have Message there? Can we look at that same verse, Message version? If we do. Can we read it together? 1, 2, go. If your home is going to be sound and beautiful, it takes wisdom and understanding. Wisdom is knowing what to say and knowing what not to say. Because there's a tendency in every human being, when you are angry, what you just want to do is to cause pain so that the person can also feel the pain you are feeling. So if somebody does something to you and you know you cannot revenge or you cannot retaliate physically, then you switch to your mouth. And then you begin to say abusive words. You see people say, see his head like, I don't know, have you ever experienced it before? That somebody is abused. And then you look at the person and all of a sudden, the person looks exactly like the picture that he was at. Hey, Rory, a big kid, I'm like, what am I? All of a sudden, it. I don't know if you have experienced that before. That is to let you know how powerful words can shape imagination. You've seen that person all these years. You never had that thought. But somebody comes from nowhere and uses the words to abuse the person, and you look the person again through the eyes of the words that have been spoken. And all of a sudden, the person looks like Otomani or Gwede be roundabout. His forehead looks like a roundabout. And you begin to laugh. But that's what words can do. You need to be careful because you need to apply wisdom. You see that your husband is getting worked up. Keep quiet. You see that your wife is becoming agitated. Keep quiet. Because sometimes your wife doesn't want, I'm sorry. She wants you to change. You read it the first time she complained. You read it the second time she complained. Now, that's what you're saying. She be upset, I'm sorry. What more do you want? Ha. Ah. You see the way they all said ha with me. By wisdom, a home is built. And it is by understanding that it is established. How I know you love me is when you do the things I want you to do. If you know something hurts me, something gets me pissed, something gets me angry, and you take joy in doing those things, then, my dear, we're incompatible. Finally, after you say I do, if there's anything that works well together in your home, it is to pray together. And I'm not saying this as a matter of tradition. Pray. I want to say some explicit things here. Pray. After you make love, pray. Both of you on your bed, naked, pray together. Hold your wife close. If you're not married, remove the imagination. Pray. Prayer of thanksgiving. Lord, I thank you for this woman in my life. I thank you for this man in my life. Pray. Before you step out of the house, pray. If she's sleeping before you left at 5 a.m. in the morning, lay your hands on her head. Pray. Do you know why? You are her priest. Don't be like Adam. And God says, why did you run away? Was it? Did you eat the fruit I told you not to eat? And what does Adam say? Adam says, it's her. It's her. Pray. And that takes it back to your eye. If you were never praying as a single, how will you now pray as a married man or a married woman? It would be terrible if you had the man that would not be asking your wife, so what are we going to do now? Ha. Where you are supposed to be the one giving vision, giving direction. This is where and how we are going. Pray. Pray when you don't feel like praying. And the reason why you need to pray is that the greatest institution the enemy hates is not the church, it's marriage. Satan hates marriage more than the church. I tell you the fact. Satan hates marriage more than the church. Do you know why? Because the church is a product of a marriage between Christ and us. Many at the wedding. They spend money on the wedding. They print ivies for the wedding. The wedding dress costs a fortune. So much is invested in a day, but they don't invest in the home. Pray. Be a warrior mom. Be a warrior dad. And that's why it is dangerous for you to say they are boring brothers in the church. Let me go and marry a good-looking guy in the street. I'll bring him to church. These our sisters in church are not fashionable. They don't know. They're always doing spirit coco here. They are not romantic. It's only Bible that they know. Let me go out and get somebody that understands this thing. I pity you. You're looking for Kama Sutra. I pity you. You hear things like, sorry, let me speak in vernacular here, because that's how they are, the pastor message. But when you just see, could just see, move up, but to just see tomorrow. Ha. He does not know what's up, but he knows the word marry, because you see, in the word, he will find what's up. That's the truth. The word will make him humble to listen to you. The word will make him attentive to listen to you. Even when your husband or your wife is giving you headache, don't go and start complaining to people, your in-laws. Complain to the one who gave him to you. Ah, I told one sister when she got married, I said her husband was giving her headache. I said, this is what you will do. When your husband is in the room, pretend like as if he's not there, but make sure he's hearing you. Go on your knees and just say, Father, thank you for giving me Luwa Shego for me. Thank you for making him my husband. Thank you for the love you give to him, Lord. Thank you because you have made him a great man. But Lord, help his hunger. Lord, you know I love him. I don't want him to go to hell. Help his hunger. Do you know what I've noticed? Let me tell you what I've noticed. Some of these rich men who don't love Christ, who are not committed to Christ, who are not really born again. Maybe they were not born again before they got married, but their wives now became born again. And their wives are prayer warriors. When they get into any kind of headache, they know where to run to. They don't joke with the prayers of their wives because they know it works. So you can be saying whatever you like outside, but when they lock the door, you say, well, can you affect me? Oh, the bang badura. Pray for me. That is the anointing of a warrior wife. She knows. Be the Queen Esther of your family. And imagine now if your husband is born again. Firebrand. If two of you shall agree on a thing, it is established. Now, it does not look like Rev. Because I tell people, when you're talking about marriage and relationships, they are not revs. These things are so simple. Unfortunately, people are expecting a PhD solution to a school start problem. That's the truth. So when you say you want to talk about relationship, now they're expecting the five immutable ways of love. But the truth about love, it is not selfish. It does not boast. It does not seek revenge. It forgives. The thing about relationship, that's what makes it very crazy for man to understand, because it is too simple. Man feels love should be complex. For God so loved the world that he gave. Rise up to your feet. You cannot understand the concept of love and commitment if you've not understood the concept of salvation. There are sisters in church this morning who maybe in times past gave their bodies to prove their love. In fact, there are some young men who gave their bodies so that they could prove that they loved. And I want to tell you today that sex is not love. It isn't. It's amazing, sir. It's amazing that Jacob loved Rachel so much, but he slept with Leah over the night and did not know who he was sleeping with. Because my question is, if Jacob loved Rachel so much, how come he slept, had sex with somebody through the night, only for him to wake up in the morning and realize that the person he had sex with was not his wife? And there are people this morning whose marital destinies may have been mortgaged or shortchanged. This morning, while I was preparing for this service, God told me, he said, there will be healing in service this morning. There will be healings. Some young men might break down with water running down their eyes because finally, you're about to let go of the past. Some things that were said to you when you are young, when you were young, and those words hurt you bad, such that now, if you hear those words anywhere, it arouses a very aggressive reaction from you. You have not healed. That was what this person said to me in 1900. If you hear things like, I don't easily get angry. Oh. I'm a good guy. I don't easily get angry. But when I get angry, something needs to give way this morning. Because whatever I do, it is affected by I. Now, Jesus loved you so much. He left his heavenly throne and came just to show you and I. That song says, how deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his blood has paid my ransom. Wherever you are this morning, lift up your two hands to the Lord and quietly talk to the Lord this morning. Heal me, Lord. Heal me, Lord. You might need healing. Heal me, Lord. Whatever it is, you may not even know you have a scar. You may not even know there's a wound within you. You may not know. Heal me, Lord. Oh, heal me, oh Lord, and I will be healed. Save me, and I will be saved. Oh, heal me, oh Lord, and I will be healed. For you are the one I praise. You are the one I praise. Lift up your two hands. There's a healing going on now. There's a healing going on now. Healing from your past mistakes. Maybe you've had family fractions. You came from a polygamous home. It affected you. Maybe you're not academically strong in school and people said things to you, and the rest of your life has just been a repeat of mistakes and mistakes and mistakes. There is a healing. There is a healing. Come to the river of life this morning.
Come to the river of life, for you will find healing in there.
Keep talking to the Lord.
Come to the river of life, come and drink freely here.
Come
if your heart is searching. Oh, come if your soul is thirsty.
Draw near and drink
from the mercies of Jesus Christ. At the river of life, there is a river that flows to the people of God, the people of God. So come if you're wounded or sad, for there is a river. There is a river. Oh, come to the river of life. You'll find healing there. Come to the river of life. Come and drink freely here. Oh, come if your heart is searching. Oh, come if your soul is thirsty.
The Lord is healing.
Draw near and drink of the mercies of Jesus Christ. At
Talk to Jesus. Talk to him. That's what this service is about this morning. Emotional wounds can be very, 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 can be more terrible than even physical wounds. What are you hurting from? What do you need healing from? Talk to the Lord this morning. He's willing to heal you if you will be open about it and say, Lord, I know this is it. This is what is wrong with my eye. This is what is wrong with me. Are you 15? Are you 19? Are you 25? Age is not a barrier. Wounds can happen to anybody at any age. Are you single? Are you in a relationship? Are you married? Are you going through a marital struggle right now? Lift up your two hands and say, Lord, heal me. Help me, Lord. Where do you find it difficult? Is there still a sense of ego, of pride within you that makes it difficult for you to submit, that makes it difficult for you to listen? Talk to the Lord this morning. He comes with healing in his wings. He comes with healing in his wings. Sometimes it might not be a fervent prayer you need. It might just be a simple but heartfelt, a simple but passionate prayer. Say, Lord, heal me. Lord, heals hearts today. Heal the souls today, Lord. Those ones crying, bleeding inside. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Somebody here, the Lord says you are afraid of marriage. He says you are afraid of it. I don't know why you are, maybe because of past experiences. He says you are afraid of it. He said there are times when you knew that the only reason that is stopping you from getting married now is you don't think you have it yet. It scares you. The Lord told me to tell you that fear is over and that this year we are going to celebrate with you. I'm led in my spirit to lay hands on a few people here this morning. I don't usually lay hands, but this morning I'm led in my spirit to. And what I'm led to do is to lay hands on the people who feel. You always have this sense of not being good enough. I don't know who you are, whether it's in your career, or it's in your academics, or in every, you always have this sense of, look, don't let me struggle to be the best. Let me just maintain my average or below average lane. I don't know who that person, but wherever you are, just take a step in faith and come forward. I want to pray with you this morning. As it begins to give me who I need to pray with, I'll just do that, then I leave. Anybody, God bless you. Whoever that person is, just take a step of faith forward. Take a step of faith forward. That person is just taking a step of being forward. There's a changing of mentality this morning. Wherever you have belittled yourself, wherever you've allowed people to belittle you to. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I don't know who that. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Some of you have lost opportunities because of this. Opportunities you should have reached out to. But because somehow your eye was messed up. Oh, thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Healing rain is falling down. Healing rain is falling. Help me sing that song.
It's falling down. Healing rain is falling.
I'm not afraid.
Not afraid. Not afraid. The healing rain is falling down. Healing rain.
Thank you, Holy Spirit. I'm not afraid.
Not afraid.
Not afraid.
Not afraid.
Healing rain.
Healing rain.
I lay my hands on you.
Not afraid.
The power of God is mighty in this room. Bring the music down, just in case you know this. The power of God is mighty in this room. The Spirit of God leads me to do this. Now, some of you are standing outside. For 2-3 minutes, just stretch out your hands to this once. Stretch out your hands. If you are not married on the choir stand, please just come to the front of the speaker. Quickly. If you are standing and your hands are raised up, my dear daddies and mommies, this is just your prayer. If you want to speak in the spirit, speak in the spirit. If you want to speak in understanding, speak in understanding. But pray. Now, those of us who are standing in the congregation, lift up your 2 hands to the Lord. I'm coming to join you myself. But your prayer for us is that we will not miss it in marriage. As the Spirit leads you, that we will not miss it. That we will not miss it. 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 In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Thank you very much. You can go to your seats. 2 things the Lord has asked me to do. There's somebody here. I don't know who you are. If you gave birth to a child out of wedlock and because of that, you think the door of marriage has closed over you, the Lord said I should tell you that this year, we're going to rejoice with you in the mighty name of Jesus. Finally, I will not leave this service. I can't until I have bring the strings, please help me. Just hold on. Jesus is I am Jesus. I'm in Jesus. If you have not received Christ as your Lord and Savior, no matter what we've done today, believe you me, you will always fall into the pitfalls of destiny. Is there anybody here that you want to accept Jesus for real? Or just maybe you know that this Christian race, it has not been easy and there have been mistakes along the way. You rise up and you fall and you just want to say, Ayo, can you just pray with me that I can have the grace to stand and stand firm? You are the last set of people I need to pray with this morning. Wherever you are, just take a step of faith forward. You need to surrender your life to Jesus, or you need to rededicate your life to Christ. Or you need to make a stand and say, look, I want to take a stand for Christ and come out. Wherever you are, whoever you are, wherever you are, don't let the enemy deprive you of this opportunity now. Don't let the enemy deprive you of this opportunity now. I'll just leave a few more seconds. Anybody? Anybody? God bless you, my sister. Anybody else? Anybody else? This is the foundation of love. This is the foundation of whatever it is. That no other foundation can be laid other than that which has already been laid, and that is Christ Jesus. Wherever you are, whoever you are. Thank you, Father. Say this after me. Say, Lord, I come to you. Take me. Accept me. Let your blood that you shed for me speak for me. I accept your love. I receive your love. Help me to walk in the reality of your love and the grace to live for you, to please you. Release to me. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Lift up. Everybody stand up to your feet. If you know this song, please sing with me and then we'll pray. I will lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. The Lord who made heaven and earth. You say, you will not soar by my foot so
for us this morning. Let your healing waters flow. Let your healing river flow. Whether there has been any damage emotionally, spiritually, in anyone's life, in this service this morning, it is healed in the name of Jesus. Father, every broken heart, every broken relationship, even every cracking marriage, Lord, this morning in this service, let there be a healing in the name of Jesus. From Powerhouse, my Lord and my Father, this morning, we raise godly homes, anointed homes, Christian homes, homes that will please the Lord in the name of Jesus. For that young man who walked into this room this morning with a sense of helplessness, feeling inferior, amounting to no good, Lord, wherever he is this morning, in today's service, let your light shine on him. In the name of Jesus. Is there anyone here this morning who has been going through a storm of depression, who may have contemplated suicide, seriously or vaguely? This morning, Almighty God, I decree and said in him was life, and the life was the light of man. I decree that your life will begin to flow into every soul in here in the name of Jesus. And every worry, every anxiety about your marital destiny, every worry, every anxiety about your marital destiny, every worry and every anxiety about your marital destiny. It is swallowed up in victory today in the name of Jesus. For those of you who have been waiting for long, your wait is over. I said your wait is over. God is about to embarrass you with the biggest gift you could have imagined in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Almighty. And when the time comes, may we all here be present with you at the marriage supper of the Lamb. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Can we give the Lord a clap offering? Can you give the Lord a clap offering? Chains are broken already. Chains are broken already. Every emotional, mental bondage that has released you, that has deprived you from loving or from receiving love, it's broken already. It's broken already. It's broken already. It's broken already. Amen. Now look for five people around them, around you, and this is what you're just going to say. You say, I, and focus on the I. Say, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I am great. I am loved. I am chosen. I am delivered. I am set free. I am who I am by the grace of the Lord. Now give God praise wherever you are.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Please let's just stretch forth our hands to the vessel that God has used for us this morning. Let's just pray that God will bless him. As he has watered us, he will continue to be watered in the name of Jesus. As virtue has flowed out of him, that God will replenish in the mighty name of Jesus. Decree what you want in your life. Decree it into his life. He has blessed us this morning. Let's pray that God will continue to bless him. He will not lack any good thing. In the mighty name of Jesus, these words will not stand against him. In the mighty name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we have prayed. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Let us put our hands together for the Lord one more time. Let's put our hands together for the Lord one more time. Let's just say, Pastor, we thank you. We love you. We appreciate you. And we pray that God will continue to bless you. Let's appreciate God in his life one more time with a round of applause. Hallelujah. So, briefly before we round up, we're one out of time, but there are a couple of things we need to do before we go. I would like to do a couple's Thanksgiving. I think it was last month, one of us, Mr. Bamidele Odufuwa, got married. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Don't hate. Rejoice. And they're doing his Thanksgiving today, and he has brought his lovely wife to the church today. So we'll be doing the Thanksgiving. So if you want what he has, not what he has, but you get what I mean. If you want what he has, rejoice with him and as they dance forward, and we'll celebrate with them. All right, so celebrate with them as they dance forward.
I come before you. And that is something that I want to say. Everybody say, you are the brother. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Somebody who is trusting God for this big miracle, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody who has received the prophecy that something is going to happen this year, shout a bigger hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I am trusting God that before 31st December 2022, you will be giving such thanksgiving like this. Come on, give the Lord a bigger hallelujah. No more sermon today, no sermon today. All the sermons have been made already. We appreciate God for what you have done in your life. And I'm actually even more happy that today's topic resonates with what you're doing. Pastor, you please come forward. It just connects the dots completely. And so that you will tap into the glory of today. I'm not going to read the word, a short passage before the prayer. It's in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9. Very, very interesting. It says, two are better than one. First, because they have a good reward for their labor. Now, verse 10 is what I love. It says, for if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him that is alone when he falleth, for he has no other to help him. He will not be alone in Jesus' name. And you never walk alone in the mighty name of Jesus. The Lord that has brought you this far will lead you further in the name of Jesus. Your home is blessed. Your union is blessed. All that you collectively desire to achieve, God will bring to pass. Unison is your purpose. It's the unction that the Lord has brought upon in the institution of marriage. The enemy will not bring division into your unison in Jesus' name. As Pastor Ayo has said, you know the tips that you want to learn. After they do, you do the prayer. You understand? I'm not going to say more than that. But if you want to take the tip, go and take the tip. Pastor Ayo, I'm quoting you. Pastor Ayo, come now. I'm quoting you directly. After they do, so there's some, you've heard all the messages, you've gone through the session. But my prayer is that the wisdom that you need for this journey, you will not lack in the mighty name of Jesus. Each time we look back upon your home, upon this journey, we will testify that truly as a city set on a hill, as an example, as a brand that we are meant to be, that is who you are and what you represent in this institution of marriage in the mighty name of Jesus. I call Pastor Ayo to say a word of blessing and declare into your home and union in the name of Jesus.
Father, we declare your word over the family of Mr. and Mrs. Bamidele. It is you that has done this great thing, and it is marvelous in our sight. I decree that this miracle that has been performed today will last eternity in Jesus' name. This marriage will be fruitful. It will be fruitful. It will be fruitful. It will be fulfilling. In the name of Jesus. Every day of this marriage will be your honeymoon.
Amen.
As wine gets older and becomes more vintage, so shall your marriage be.
Amen.
You will never have a better yesterday.
Amen.
It gets better and better and better.
Amen.
Mr. Bamidele, everything your hands are laid upon will prosper.
Amen.
Because of your family, whatever your wife lays her hands upon will prosper.
Amen.
When people are looking for the kind of marriages they want theirs to be like, that we find yours as an example.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So shall it be.
Amen.
This marriage will bring you closer to God.
Amen.
And will bring you closer to each other.
Amen.
And is there anyone, anywhere, who may have said that they are not happy that you got married, and they will make it their life's intention to make your marriage a frustration? I decree their extinction now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Be fruitful.
Amen.
Multiply.
Amen.
Dominate.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Congratulations, sir. Congratulations, sir. Congratulations, ma. What I normally do is, do you have a pet name for her yet? What's your pet name for her? My queen. do you have a pet name for him yet? What's your pet name? Wait, keyboardist. What's your pet name for him? The love of my life. Okay, so I give you 30 seconds to say something to your queen. And show these small boys, all of us that we are still growing, how it is done. Yes. This is not the marriage vow. You have married already, but just something, just let's really know how queenly she is to you.
As you know, you are the queen of my heart. You know, I always love you. I always hold you dear to my heart. As long as I breathe, you always be my love. I love you.
Respond. Quiet now. Brother, see the way you hold two chairs and you are paying attention. Yes. Now listen, this is the word of a wife, not a girlfriend. It's different. Uh-huh. Now let's hear it.
The love of my life. You've made me so happy. Words are not enough to express how happy I am to be with you. To be your wife. And I pray that our love will last forever.
Amen. Oh Lord. If you know you want something like, just say, I receive. God bless you.
God bless you as you go forward in Jesus' name. This is the longest conversation I've had publicly shared in this church. Well, well worth it. Thank you very much. On behalf of some of us who didn't get the memo, we appreciate all the people who worked in getting this shared today. I don't know who you are, but God bless you. This really brought color to the service today. For the people who were read deliberately without sharing with others and encouraging others, God is watching all of you.
We judge you.
God is watching all of you. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's not like I'm crying or anything, but it's fine. It's fine. If you are single, just stoop over at me. Shout hallelujah. If you are single, shout hallelujah. If you are a single sister, shout hallelujah. If you are a single brother, shout hallelujah. Oh yeah, brothers, come. Anything tomorrow, the Lord can do something. I believe the Lord is the God of wonders. Between today and tomorrow is too much. God can do something. Hallelujah. Let's quickly go through a few announcements before we head out. If you're worshiping with us for the first time and you were not here when we made the announcement the first time, please can you just wave if you're worshiping with us for the first time? And you came in after we made the initial announcement. Is there anybody? There's somebody. All right, please, let's put our hands. Let's welcome her. Is it her or him? It's a her. Okay, welcome, ma. Welcome. Please, can you carry your bag to the front? And we'd like to welcome you. Thank you for coming. God bless you. God bless you. All right, so this is Powerhouse. We're a church, we're a parish under Youth Province 7, the perfect province, and we're on a mission to create heaven-conscious world changes. You're welcome, huh? You're welcome. And yes, YP Youth Province 7 Workers Retreat holds on Saturday, on the 19th of February. That's this Saturday, and it is compulsory for all workers. Compulsory for all workers. Is there transport? Okay, so takeoff is from here. What time? Seven on a Saturday. Take off from here is at 7. We're organizing transport, so take off from here is AM. If you come here at PM, you're on your own. I'm sorry, there's nothing I can do for you. So next Sunday, the 20th of February, is the RCCG Youth Global Prayer Walk. Hallelujah! Let's put our hands together for the Lord. Yes, we did that last year. And we're doing it again this year. So please come in any RCCG t-shirt. or an evangelism t-shirt and comfortable walking shoes. That's very important. Please, ladies, please come in comfortable walking shoes. Or if you are wearing heels, come with the slippers or the walking shoes in your bag. We are begging, all right? And we printed a global prayer walk t-shirt last year. If you still have your own, you can wear it, or any Redeemed shirt at all. Okay, Youth Connect happens every Sunday at 6 p.m. Youth Connect is happening this evening at 6 p.m. So please make sure to join. It's happening on Zoom, and the link will be sent to the WhatsApp group. If you're not on the WhatsApp group, please meet the media department at the back to give them your number so that you can be added to the church WhatsApp group. We have prayers every day at 5:30 to end the ongoing fast. How many of us are fasting? You are in church, you don't know. How many of us are fasting? How many of us don't know that there's a fast going on? Okay, let me know who we are. But there's a fast going on. We're currently fasting and we're almost there. Should be ending March 2nd. We're almost there. All right. So please let's join the fast if we've not already been fasting. And there are prayers every day at 5:30 to end the ongoing fast. That happens on Zoom. Midweek services holds on Wednesday at 6 p.m. At 6 p.m., please always make it down here at 6 p.m. for midweek service. It always promises to be a rewarding time. It's become a family meeting, a village meeting. We just come here, we talk, we go in depth, and we bear our hearts out. There are certain questions that you have concerning some things, and it's at midweek service that we have time to actually thrash it out. So please, Wednesday, 6 p.m., please be here for midweek service. To join the School of Disciples, please see Uncle Kolapo after the service. For those who don't know, call up, please. Uncle Akko, please wave. Please wave. If you don't know, Uncle Akko, please wave. Yes, he's that fine looking man on that side of the auditorium. okay, next week, Sunday, we have a panel discussion. Please drop your questions with the ushers, or you can send a message to PMB, Mrs. Badiru, on 0806 004 30 04. I call the number again, 0806 004 3004. If you have any question concerning the panel discussion next week, if there's any question you want us to address next week, please send her a message, or you can drop it, write it now and drop it with the ushers. All right, and we have recording of messages. They're available at the media desk that's at the back of the church. Please reach out to the media team for recording of messages. Now, thanks to all the ladies who found time to attend the Women in Ministry conference yesterday. God bless you. Please put your hands together. It's like it seems it was very powerful from the applause that I'm getting. And on that note, the Women of Courage Health Organization are introducing its first health and fitness work tagged Walking in Power. I think there's a flyer that will be shared around by the ushers. Walking in Power, and this is specifically targeted at the ladies, and it says, ladies, let's walk in power as we move mountains and take territories with our strides. 10 earliest birds gets health gifts, and there's so many things you can learn, and there's also a high level of networking. It's happening it's happening on Saturday from 7:30 to 9:30. So if you are not a worker joining us for the workers meeting, you can be a part of this, and it's the meeting point is here at Christ Church. All right, and the dress code is decent sportswear, hashtag remove. Amen. So Powerhouse's vision for the to bring as many people as possible to God. So we have to make evangelism watchword during this period. Please, can you put Proverbs 11:30 up on the screen? Okay, so there are two sets of people that have to see Uncle Kolapo after the service. All right, this first set is for something that has to do with workers. So if you hear your name, please see Uncle Kolapo after the service. From prayer department, Goldie Joshua. Number two, Sister Kane Day, then Sukomi Akinowo. From Believers and Baptism class, Victoria Akonwo. From the media department, Damilola Ayonwuyi, Amos Akonwo, Okora for Prosper, Ogumuyiwage Kindele Kiki. From Embrace team, Ibukon Akonwo, Ekane Minimfong, Adeniyi Mobong. From the technical team, Samson Emmanuel and Bele Maiwa. From the ushering team, Tina Omoren, Alan Tosin, Joseph Anyekan. From the choir, Moses, lead guitarist, Emmanuel Andy, and Tola Oshin. And then from sanitation, Dapo Jebutu. So you guys need to see on Colabo after the service. So, and there's also a second list that needs to see Uncle Colapo also. Colapo is so busy. Moji, Adaye, Sukami, IBK, Niyi, Jude, Shalewa, and Tola. So I think there are a few people that appear on both lists. So just after service, just go and hold Uncle Colapo, and wherever he wants to see you, he'll see you. But you know where to find Uncle Colapo. Hallelujah. There are two books for the month that we are reading. Two books. One is called How to Choose a Life Partner, 165 Questions to Ask. And that's written by Pastor Bimbo Odukoya. And this one is also titled After the Honeymoon, also written by Pastor Bimbo Odukoya. So, I mean, this is the I do before and after. Before and after. So the books are available at Wisdom Porch. That's our library, for those who don't know, our library for the church, Wisdom Porch. The book is available for rental, or if you want to have your own copy and buy, also speak to them. Believers class also holds after the service. Believers class holds after the service. If you'd like to be a part of Believers class, please see Pastor Goodness. Goodness, please raise your hand. For those who want to be a part of the walk, the fitness walk, please, you can see blessing, please raise your hand. Blessing, she's there looking lovely in the yellow. All right, I think that's it. All right, I'll see you guys. We'll see this evening, Youth Connect, 6 p.m. Please, can we rise on our feet? Can we rise on our feet? Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Closing prayer. Isaiah 43:18-19. But the Lord says, do not cling to events of the past or dwell on what happened long ago. Watch for the new thing I'm going to do. I can hear amen. It is happening already. You can see it now. I will make a road through the wilderness and give you streams of water there. Praise the Lord. Let us thank God for the word that he has spoken to close the service for us. He says, don't cling on the event of the past. He has started to do a new thing. Open your eyes and see that new thing that God is saying, what God is already doing. That thing that is above what you can imagine. Open your eyes and you see it. And in conclusion, he says, he will give you streams of water there. You'll be rooted. You'll be planted. You'll be fruitful, even where God is locating you, in the name of Jesus. Can we share the grace? Surely.
Hallelujah. Have a lovely week. Thank you.
Thank you.